We need to finish round five, so I will use the time, explain a little bit about the microbiological parameters in fishery products and the tests. So it's not water now, it's the fishery products, and there we have our famous legislation. It's the 27.3 from 2005. Are you knowing the legislation? So if you want to have a look at the legislation, you can consult the internet, but you have always to find the latest consolidated version with all the changes. Because when I looked at the internet, you will see that we have a change in the legislation that applies from 1st January onwards. We have a new requirements for testing of bivalves in we will see on the next slide. Changes will apply from next year onwards, and it will be a different sampling plan. And as we have discussed before, the food business operators, the industry is responsible for fish safety, food safety, fish safety, so to say. They apply HACCP system. They try to prevent the risks that could, public health risk that could occur. And this regulation more or less sets some criteria for the food industry. It establishes food safety criteria for relevant pathogens, also for bacteria and their toxins and metabolites. For instance, we have it sets criteria for Salmonella, for Listeria monocytogenes in specific foods, but also histamine is regulated in here. Also, it's a chemical substance. And the food safety criteria define the acceptability of a product, a batch or food that is placed on the market. It also establishes certain hygiene criteria which apply in the process to indicate the correct functioning of the process. And EU has, in the same time as they developed the microbiological regulation, which came in force in 2005 as part of our new food law and the new food safety system, established reference laboratories. So we have several reference laboratories on certain pathogens. So we have one on Salmonella, we have one on Listeria, we have one reference laboratory on E. coli, and they all work in the same aspects, that they develop test methods, they provide training, they organize proficiency testing, they might also help to produce reference materials, and they also provide training, for instance, for not only our member state laboratory, also for third countries. So for instance, the reference laboratory in for Listeria, they are at the moment developing a swab test for Listeria for the industry. And if you go to their website, all the information, most of the information is free available. And some information is only available for member states. But the microbiological criteria, they came into force as a main objective to ensure a high level of human health protection. So these criteria, we will next see what this means. They should enhance food safety, they should be feasible in practice and based on scientific risk assessment. They provide basically a reference point to assist food business and competent authorities in their activities to manage, monitor the safety of food products. And for the food industry, to verify HACCP measures. I will give you an example. The microbiological criteria comprises, and I will next slide give you an extract from the regulation. the microorganism of concern, the analytical method, the sampling plan, number of sample units you take, size of the analytical unit, the microbiological limits, the foodstuff to which it concerns, the point of the food chain where the limits apply, and action to be taken when in case of unsatisfactory results. This is an extract of the 27.3 and the annex. So we only test certain food products on certain microbiological risks. And basically in the beginning, the 27.3 was very much focused on food products of animal origin, including fish and the risks. And whereas now, based on scientific risk assessment, also risks in foods and vegetables are included, because also people could die, so to say, if they eat, for instance, melons. They are contaminated with salmonella, which we didn't know, because you need to have a good epidemiological data, which the US has, so many of the information we get from the US, and everything that went through risk assessment, and when there is opinion that it should be regulated, and if there will be set a microbiological criterion, then it comes into the regulation. So for instance, if we have a look at fish and fishery products, you see that there are some requirements to test cooked crustaceans and mollusks, shellfish on salmonella. There's a sampling plan to be applied. There are the limits. The ISO method, this is from interest for us, that applies for official control tests and also for industry. But industry has this option again that they can use screening or alternative test, which is comparable to the EU method. And then also it always relates to the stage of the food chain. If you see, microbiological risk could enter all the time in the food chain. It's not the same like chemical risk assessment. If you give once pesticides in the beginning, then the level of pesticides wouldn't change, whereas for the microbiological risk assessment, we have this situation that, for instance, the pathogens can enter, re-enter the chain at many points, where we need scientific proof where this could be, for instance. And very often we have recontamination also at home. But as long as the products are into processing, based on risk assessment, there are some decisions taken at what place in the food chain you have to apply for what commodities the test. Very often these are for the products placed on the market, whereas in the we also have process parameters where we more or less try to check the processing, so the microbiology in the processing. This means sampling plan in microbiology. Very often we have two-class sampling plans or three-class sampling plans. This is a two-class sampling plan. We take, the competent authority takes five samples. Yes. And in none of the samples should be found something, so absent of 25 grams. And for you important is, of course, that you know you need to have five samples. Yeah. And then the method to apply. But this you don't find in our manual. This is you test them separately because Also for the histamines, I will tell you tomorrow because we will see the screen. You test the 9 samples individually because for the histamines we have a 3-class sampling plan. You test 9 and they all should be between 100 and 200 milligram per kilogram, but 2 could exceed the level, but not more. And then the whole consignment is allowed to be placed on the market. The regulation is not there, but I explain the sample preparation. If for histamines it is explained, and also when you pool samples, it's explained, for instance, when this is a requirement. No, this is how it works. You have to pick your things. Also, very often sample preparation you don't find in ISO standards. Then you need to ask colleagues or find other standards, for instance, for heavy metal analysis. Reference from the legislation goes to one standard for the sample preparation, more or less, because it's also not so easy to understand. For heavy metals, very often you have, if you analyze heavy metals, you could have matrix effect. And then they say you need to use matrix modifier, and then you don't know maybe what the matrix modifier is and which one you need to take. And all this information, for instance, is in one standard for sample preparation. But we don't have it all the time. I also checked BAM, when, you know, to see, because you can also homogenize if in the microbiology, or you use Stomacher. If you have one, you cannot use the Stomacher for very, big amount and very, it has to be soft a little bit. You cannot put a nut, maybe a nut. It cannot be homogenized in a stomacher. Yeah. So this depends. Also, sample preparation is very interesting, also because the matrix could is very relevant. So, but here the sampling plan is more or less clear. Always in microbiology, you have 2 or 3 class sampling plans, and there was recently a change. This was relevant for us, so it's also explained in the regulation. You will also have footnotes, what this mean, and then also interpretation of results is also included. I only wanted to show you where the sampling plan comes from. And of course, the inspectors need to know this. And you also, because now if they come, for instance, you have now, you need to test, for instance, Salmonella in the live bivalves. And you know, I need 5 samples. And for instance, for histamine, this is also not written somewhere, but it's written in something I will tell you tomorrow. It's not so easy. But you need more or less 100 gram always, yeah? If it's not a package, you take 100 grams. And here you need to do separate sample preparations, and you do the analysis for any of the samples. And then you have 5 results. For instance, in all the 5 results, you need to have absence of the Salmonella in 25 grams. So the test unit would be 25 grams, you homogenize, and so on and so forth. And if you have in one sample something, so then you have to tell this the inspectors, and they have to take action. The slide, only I thought it might be interesting for you, because from next year onwards the criterion for E. coli for will apply for the live bivalve mollusks. So it's an amendment to the legislation. It's 2 pages where they explain more or less what has been changed. And always with the amendments, you cannot find them easily in the internet because they have a different number, which you don't know, of course. But then if you browse the word, or if you are informed by colleagues, you will know. So now, you see, they changed the sampling plan. and set an upper and lower limit. And this comes from Codex. The interpretation you also find in the amendment to the legislation. Satisfactory if all the five values observed are smaller than 230 mpn per 100 gram of flesh and liquid, or if not one of the five values observed is above 230 mpn per 100 gram of flesh. So one above is allowed. Listeria is also ready to eat food products. I don't know if you are testing for them or if this is a trade commodity. You have to take for the more sensitive group, infants and ready to eat food products for special medical purposes, 10 samples, and none of them you have a finding. It's only for information, I mean purposes. Listeria analysis or listeria detection is also covered in the manual. So what we have covered in the manual, test methods are 8 that are relevant for the fish in, sector and the fish and fishery products. This is colony count at 30 degrees, Salmonella, Clostridium, coliforms, E. coli, coagulase positive Staphylococci, Vibrio, and Listeria monocytogenes. And you all find them with the references as indicated in the manual. And you see that we have some changes. We have a new standard for E. coli from 2015. Colony count revision from 2013, and especially new ISO standard from 2015. If you see, this standard is microbiology of the food chain, horizontal method for the enumeration of microorganism, part 1, colony count at 30 degrees Celsius by the pour plate technique. Pour plate technique we heard before, but it's applicable always to products intended for human consumption, animal feed, also for environmental samples in production and handling. So basically it can also be used for swapping, and it has a good application to products that require reliable count when low detection limits are specified. And you also do the same as we discussed before. You do dilutions on the samples and you prepare pour plates in plate count agar, and then you have different kind of incubation temperature. But it's a long time, 72 hours, after which the colonies are growing in the medium, and then you count the colonies. The equipment now, this more or less the same as we discussed before for water, autoclaves, incubators, petri dishes, colony counters, but the medium is different. And for the general dilutions that are used, like peptone salt solution, buffered peptone water, reference is provided to the ISO 6887 standard from 2014, and then we use plate count agar. And here I have presented sample preparation, and you plant 50 gram of the analytical unit for 2 minutes, and then you make dilutions very promptly of the original. And as before, but here we do dilutions, but we take from the homogenized material 10 mils and dilute it in dilution in 90 milliliter of diluent, and then we take 1 milliliter aliquots and transfer it to the petri dishes. So it's the same principle as we heard for the water. And selection of dilutions that give counts between, I found 15 and 300, but I think also 30 to 300 would be good. And then you prepare the PCR agar cooled to 44 to 47 degrees in a petri dish. Mix, allow to solidify, and incubate inverted and on the given temperature. And also the standard tells you if you have a high amount of samples that how high you could stack the samples and how you put it into the incubator. And then you, after incubation, you count the number of colonies on the plate and calculate the number of coliform units. And with the links, they go to YouTube videos. And if you would have a problem how to count, how to dilute, there are quite some helpful videos, really, where you can see many different things, how to count colonies, how to do the dilutions, or and questions. ISO standard for detection of Salmonella, which is ISO standard 6579 from 2002. There was one amendment in 2007 which needs to be followed up, a smaller one. It's a horizontal method for detection of Salmonella, including Salmonella typhi and paratyphi. In products intended for human consumption, also in feeding stuff and environmental samples. So Salmonella is very often on the surface of animals, for instance, and meaning also with this kind of method you could use for swapping as well in environmental samples. Principle is giving in the method, you have four stages. You have a non-selective pre-enrichment stage where buffered peptone water is inoculated with the sample and incubated at 37 degrees for 18 hours. So you have more or less a pre-enrichment for already 18 hours. And pH is relevant. Then you have selective enrichment in liquid media. You use two different kind of broths, which we will see later. They are inoculated with the pre-enrichment cultures, and samples on the RVS broth is incubated for 41 hours at 41 degrees or 41.5 degrees for 24 hours, and the samples in the Müller-Kaufmann broth is incubated at 37 degrees for 24 hours. And each of this selective enrichment after the non-selective is then plated out on two selective solid media. And one of those medias need to be the XLD agar, and it will be incubated at 37 degrees. And results are examined after 24 hours. And the second one is selective agar can be chosen by the laboratory for isolating lactose-positive Salmonella. And then you also can have a confirmation activity. So equipment that you need to have is given by the standard, like usual. It's autoclave, incubator, water bath, pH meter, pipettes. Which is the common equipment you might have in the laboratories, but the reagents and the buffers are various, and the media which you need to prepare. So information is given by the standard. And the sampling we have discussed, it comes from the 2703. So for instance, for cooked crustacea, you sample five live mollusks, and you don't have a finding in 25 crumb, and each sample is analyzed for the presence of Salmonella. And since you have to have the finding in 25 gram, the analytical unit is 25 gram, taken from 100 gram random taken sample unit. And samples are weighted aseptically into blending containers, so everything has to be also done aseptically. Then sterile process added, and then you are blending for 2 minutes. Basically, you could follow, everything is also written in the manual. You could follow it up there. You mix then 25 gram of the sample with the pre-enrichment medium to come to 1:10 dilution. And then you incubate at 37 degrees for 18 hours. This is what we have to discuss. Then you transfer 0.1 mil. To a tube containing 10 milliliters of the RVS prose and 1 milliliter to a tube containing the Müller-Kaufmann prose, and then you incubate these different tubes at different temperatures for different time, and you plate out on different agar, and one specified and the others as you have chosen, and then the plates are looked at for typical colonies for Salmonella. They have a plex center and they are lightly transparent, zone of a reddish color around, and then you can also apply confirmation test. This is an overview of the standard method. If you do it, you see it takes very long. It can take up, we don't see it here down there, including confirmation, it could last 11 days. And there is also a commercial test available. There are many there, especially for Salmonella. We have selected many of these commercial tests in our manual. Many of the commercial tests also have this pre-enrichment phase for 18 hours. In total, you might have a result in, I guess, 24 hours, which is much quicker than if you go through the official ISO standard method, which takes really, really long. You see 1 day for the pre-enrichment, then day two, transfer in the enrichment with the specific pros, then the plating out. We are already there, day three, and then incubation and confirmation, day five. And here with, for instance, Rambaugh quick Salmonella method, you transfer 0.1 mil of the pre-enrichment into 10 milliliter of this quick Salmonella broth, which you have ready there. And then you incubate only for 7 hours at 41.5 degrees. Then you streak it out on a chromogenic agar. This is the same principle, like we discussed before, and incubated 80 to 24 hours. So in total, I guess, you have the reading ready for most of the commercial test kits in 48 hours. Absence with the Salmonella, and what you have in the manual is also performance criteria, quality control, and we put in the manual also an overview on rapid tests, commercial tests, and you can also have a look at the FDA BAM or on the EOAC approved tests and which tests they allow. And you have many different test kits that operates in different ways. Of course, many laboratories nowadays use PCR for detection of pathogens. This is also a trend. You also have quicker results, much quicker results with PCR technique. And but for the tests, the commercial test kits that work with chromogenic agar again, you always need to have this selective enrichment stage, and which takes some time. And as said, most of the results you will have in 48 hours or less, I think, maybe 47 hours, but it will not be quicker in depending on this enrichment protocol. This is, for instance, what when we had a look at what's all available, this different kind of technologies, this would also depend on your laboratory, if you have a PCR there. I see from working with many laboratories that there is a trend to go in the microbiology more or less to the PCR technique for the pathogens. But you think also you need to confirm then, again, with the official method. Okay, this was it to the microbiology. More or less, what we did is we put any of the methods that would be relevant also for the food products coming from the 27.3 into the manual.